to help ourselves. I actually find that. Chapter 3 is called Towards an Imperfect Theology of Failure, sort of. And this week, what we're discussing is sin. We look at the whole question of sin. What is it and how did it get into the world? Sin is a word that isn't used very much anymore, especially outside the circles of the church. And when it is, it means something very different. It's become to be associated with little misdemeanors, like eating too much ice cream, something that is naughty but nice. But the Bible's understanding of sin is that it is that failure that is at the heart of all people and all things that prevents us from doing what is good and right, which separates us from God and from one another and causes turmoil within the human heart. And I argue in this chapter that without a proper understanding of sin, we'll never really understand human failure and we won't truly comprehend the grace of God. I rather cheekily say that one of my favourite doctrines is the doctrine of total depravity, that view put forward by the Reformers that sin has corrupted the whole of human experience and there's nothing that we can do to help ourselves. I actually find that really comforting because when you're as low as you can go, the only way is up. And it reminds me that I can totally and utterly rely on the work of God through Christ's resurrection to bring hope and redemption and healing. One of the things that we consider in this chapter is how all of our individual sins put together contribute to the malaise of society and the world at large. Sin isn't just something personal. When I fail to do something right, it affects you and others. We don't exist in isolation from each other. Structural sins are those sins that run deep and those things that are simply wrong in the world, in the structures and systems, cultural, economic, political, that lead to injustice, poverty, and inequality. At the end of the chapter, I suggest 4 ways in which we might be really good sinners. The first is to admit that we're sinful, and that doesn't mean that we're not beautiful and good and glorious. Of course we are. But we're also fallen, and we get things wrong, and we damage each other, ourselves, and the world around. Admitting it prevents us from having to be perfect, and from demanding perfection in others, and being disappointed when we don't see it. It's the much more honest stance before God, who is more ready to forgive than we are ever to say sorry. Secondly, I talk about getting into training, developing habits that lead us closer to God and more align our desires with God's heart. It might be interesting to compare notes on what those habits are for you. I encourage us to sin big, to acknowledge the part that we play in the sins of the world and to join in with God in putting them right one day at a time. And finally, I suggest that we might develop the forgetfulness of God. The Bible tells us that God takes our sins, good sinners.